Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Hey, good morning, and welcome to Superintendent Spotlight. And again, we broadcast every Thursday here from Westfield Technical Academy, and we are in Studio 120 in the Graphic Arts Department, so it's awesome
fully
to be here.
Fully manned today?
Fully
yeah.
manned today.
Well, break happened and kind of people disappeared, but they're getting used to the schedule. So
yeah. Good. Hey, good. Pete, I want you to be a part of our show today because we have no guests. I want you to know.
I got to change me out. Hold on.
Yeah, okay.
He's going to patch me back in. Hold on.
Well, because I think you'll have some insight for us. And but before we get there, what's the weather? It's nice out, right? I know it's 70 in here.
It's going to be cloudy and cloudier today in the 50s. And
it's going to get to 50 this afternoon, but it's 38
right now. A lot of
rain
starting around midnight tonight.
Okay. Well.
Carrying into tomorrow, but, you know, again, it's not snow.
Yeah, no, it's exactly. Not snowing. I'll be happy. And I think an early spring is coming.
Oh,
and
for sure.
You know, my pond is in my backyard is fully thawed already, and it's in March. That usually doesn't happen. So
that's pretty neat.
Yeah. So, today in our show, we're going to tackle a few things, Pete. And the first one is going to be the coronavirus. So,
right. I don't know if you noticed, but Akinyele Lovelace, primary care physician in town,
yes,
was on with Tina yesterday, and he was saying, basically, prepare for the flu. This is going to be a nasty
yes.
flu.
Right.
A lot more people are going to get it because we don't have any immunities at all built
well,
up
no flu,
to it.
There's no flu shot for it
right.
either.
There's no immunities built up for it, so right. a lot more people will be susceptible. Populations that are susceptible to the flu, that have upper respiratory issues already,
right.
are going to be particularly susceptible.
Right.
Sure.
And it's just going to be a really nasty virus going around. It's no different. The panic is unwarranted.
Thank
the
you. Concern, I'm sorry. What was that? The panic is what?
Unwarranted.
Yeah.
The concern is warranted.
Right.
I think.
Correct.
I think
Correct.
All the panic that's happening right now, we're about a week to 10 days early.
I agree.
Because the plume hasn't started yet.
Right.
Now, if you're reading, like I had a lot of concerns this week because my son was scheduled to go to Spain
right.
to visit his girlfriend who's studying abroad this year. And I started reading about Spain. Spain's taking the precautions we just started to do. They're about 5 days ahead of us.
Right. No
they
travel.
Canceled all travel to Italy. They're starting to have outbreaks in hotels now.
Sure.
So I said to Timmy.
It's inevitable.
I said to Timmy, you may get out of this country, but you may not get back in. And that
exactly.
was before this was yesterday morning.
Right.
So before the presidential announcement, I said, are you prepared to live there for a month if you have to? Do you have enough funds to do that? Does our health care, because he's in my family plan,
right.
is it covered there? You have to worry about these things. And finally, he stepped back and said, you know what? I said, it's too much of a risk at this point to potentially affect my grandparents.
Yeah, good boy.
And my Army National Guard unit.
Good. Right.
So he actually stepped back and thought about it. And then he was on the phone with several hours of trying to cancel his flight and get his money back and things like that. So. But that's became a real concern for me, and I started reading about how other countries are dealing with this right now, and they're, you know, Italy waited too long.
They did. I agree.
They waited too long. Like I said, I think we're a couple days ahead of it, but there's a lot of cases already blooming in the Berkshires, and those are a lot of people that come up from New York City that commute down from
exactly.
the Berkshires
yeah,
and things
there.
Like that.
Yeah, sure.
So they're in a metropolitan. Well, that's right now on our doorstep. So we have to be wary of it. But I wouldn't panic. And
well,
that was the message that Dr. Lovelace gave. And Kenny actually pulled that segment out and posted it as its own interview last night. And he posted that one half an hour segment we had with Dr. Lovelace. And just a general conversation
well,
about it.
The thing is, what people have to understand is, like you said, the flu gets us all. It comes, I mean, it doesn't pick and choose. You can all get it. That's why you give you some people get the flu shot to avoid it.
Right.
There is no flu shot for this. It's a virus, clearly. But, you know, we've made some communications with people in terms of we sent out something to staff and families yesterday, and I'm going to review that.
Yes.
You did put it out to the general public as well yesterday. I saw that.
Yes,
we
did.
On the school's page.
Yes.
Yeah. But as many are aware, there is a heightened focus on the coronavirus. And I do want to say that I don't know if this is a fair statement, but I think that there's so much hype on the news and the media that it's causing people it's causing anxiety actually. But it has been officially named, by the way, for anyone who wanted to hear COVID-19 or coronavirus. But at this time, the potential for possible exposure in our district remains low. You know, we are receiving guidance from our local health department. I want to shout out Joe Rouse and Deb Melvana.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
who
I'm,
have been wonderful with us, taking every phone call. I'm probably on the phone with them half the day yesterday.
Yeah, I was messaging sure. Joe, and I was talking to him about getting ahead of this on video, maybe have him coming over and do an update or going over to the office and doing a taped update.
Sure. Right.
Because on Channel 15... for a couple days now, since the beginning of the week, I've been running the last CDC call that they had. They had a conference call with public and private entities, and they were giving their updates. So there's new information out, but I've been running that with all the prevention stuff.
Right.
So it's been a half-hour block that I've been running as much as I possibly can on Channel 15 as a rotating block.
and trying to get the information out there. So it's as it gets worse, it's almost going to be an hourly thing.
Right.
To run at the top of the hour, and I'll probably bump other programming to do it.
Well, it makes sense because I think there's a lot of concerned people, and there is reason. I mean, listen, certainly, my parents are elderly too, and I talked with them. If they need anything, I'll go to the grocery store for them or whatever that they need, because it affects elderly and people with weakened immune systems at this point. I mean, I think that's the most part, but young people can be carriers is really what...
Correct.
I think that's what we've heard too. But we're receiving guidance from the local health department, the Massachusetts Department of Public Health, and the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education to ensure that we are as ready as we can possibly be in the event this pandemic becomes more widespread in our area. But I also want to say, too, you turn on the news and you hear that Mount Holyoke and Smith and Amherst.
So all of the campuses that I do public safety for now
are basically closing.
They're closing to students, and then they're switching to distance learning for the balance of the semester.
Which I know
Westfield State's taken a measured approach.
Right.
And they're talking about restarting classes on the 30th, but if the wave hits as long and as potentially the duration of it, that might not happen either. They may not be able to come back on the 30th.
They might have to do distance learning. And I know because we were supposed to have Credit for Life yesterday, and that got postponed by Westfield State.
Yep.
And, we usually have a career fair there in April. That is likely to be postponed as well.
Of public gatherings for a good period of time are probably going to be going to be out of commission.
Which makes total sense.
Yeah.
Small
gatherings are still on. So, I got guidance from TheaterWorks Hartford. They have an audience of about 170, 190.
Right.
The play that they have going on right now, what they're saying is we're going to cap the audience at 100 people. Which is the guidance from CDC is to limit your audience size to 100 or less. And what they're saying is if you're not going to use your tickets, notify them so that they can open up seats for people who want to go. So next Tuesday I still have a play. I know that JPEG Luca has not canceled, and nor will I think he will cancel the Screaming Orphans tomorrow or Robbie Folks on Sunday. So
you think he will or you don't think he will?
I don't think he will because they just advertised it again. So I think that's still going to happen.
But the other thing is I think for some – the hysteria has hit that I worry about for things that you charge and you need to make money to you don't lose your shirt. I wonder if those are going to be affected because I know there are people who are staying home and not going out. And there's that fear factor of not wanting to be in large crowds.
Right. And then that's going to happen too. I know that the middle school was concerned about the money they paid for the rights to Peter Pan and whether they're going to be able to do that show.
Well, and we're going to talk about that, too.
We will
talk about that because I'm using the word postpone, Pete, because I am optimistic that in May and June we can do some of these things. And so I'll talk about that in a minute. But I also want to just, remind people, and this was in our communication, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. Wash your hands with soap and water for 20 seconds. Avoid touching your eyes, your nose, or mouth. Cover your mouth and nose when sneezing or coughing with a tissue or use your elbow. Don't go into your hands and then shake somebody's hand. Stay away from people who are sick and stay home when you are sick. And we are cleaning and disinfecting hard surfaces that are regularly touched. And, of course, we are using cleaning products that contain the appropriate concentrations of disinfectant for disease prevention. The symptoms of COVID, again, they mimic the flu and other viruses. And that's, fever, cough, difficulty breathing. Other symptoms could include the chills, sore throat, headache, muscle aches, abdominal pain, vomiting, and all that. And the CDC is recommending that you monitor your health for at least 14 days after possible exposure and, of course, call your
See, that's
healthcare
the hardest
provider.
Like, if you run across somebody that hasn't presented symptoms yet, you could still be infected. So...
That
you don't
person
know
could
if,
be.
You don't, but you could also be. You could also get it in transmission on the incubation stage, probably if they're
potentially.
Confident.
But we got word from the State Department of Health yesterday that this particular virus really is. It's obviously more contagious and severely contagious to someone who is symptomatic. If they're not symptomatic yet, there's
so
a very
fine.
low chance.
Okay.
That's what Joe told us yesterday. So,
see, I'm glad we're getting information out. Other than my problem is the hype on the national media, and this is my complaint with them. Here's my complaint: they're beholden to the advertisers for their budgets. So, therefore, they have to hype to get more eyeballs to see them. So, I watched CNN last night and Cuomo's show, and he had on his brother, the governor, and his brother was somewhat hyping and then somewhat facting. So there was a little bit of both. And he, you know, he's playing the game, the political game. But
sure,
I'm not happy when politicians are making political fodder out of this. Just give us the facts. And that's what the CDC is doing.
Well,
that's what the local health department is doing. And that's what our local government seems to be doing in general. The local governments are getting out the straight facts.
However, you know, and I have to stay away from Facebook, Pete. I can't do it.
I know,
it.
It's brutal.
Can't do it.
But it's brutal. But I think what you're saying is, both of you are saying, is very valid. And this is the message I think we want our parents and our community members and our staff and our students to know of Westfield Public Schools, that look at the facts, okay? Look at what the CDC and the health departments are telling us, because that's what we're following. That's the guidance we're following.
Well, that's what you have to.
Of course. We're taking our lead from the medical professionals, right? The experts in the field. Stefan and I are educators, okay? We're educators first and foremost to our core. And we believe that educating our students and staff and family members right now, following the guidance of the medical professionals, is what we're doing and what we're going to do. Should a medical professional give us a different avenue to take, we will take
a different
avenue. Well,
that's what we're going to take. Absolutely.
Right,
so
right.
I'm going to call it out right now. I mean, there was clearly something that happened at the intermediate school yesterday. And, you know, and actually anything that comes to me in regard to this, my first call is to Joe Rouse or Deb Mulvena, whichever one picks up first, you know.
Right.
And, and again, I have to acknowledge that they're taking my calls and they know this is important. And in cases where, you know, I go by their guidance. And if there's something that comes up that's new, they will potentially also call the Mass DPH, right? So we get their guidance
as well. Well, because they have to, too, at some report.
Oh, they have to report it.
Yeah.
But yesterday, we followed, you know, when there was the possibility that there was a staff member that may have been exposed to someone else who may have been exposed. I mean, we're talking a lot of mays here.
It's the mays.
Six degrees of coronavirus.
Exactly, you know. And so, but just as a precaution, okay, we evacuate, well, the room was already empty, but we just shut it down and cleaned that room from top to bottom, disinfected it, and sanitized it. Now, in reality, based on the information that we gave, we didn't even have to do that. It wasn't even necessarily recommended because, like you said, 6 degrees of the coronavirus, you know, you don't know. But we also, last night, cleaned the building and all the surfaces, and I had an email today. Well, what about this teacher walked all over the place? Listen, all the floors were zambonied. They won't know what that means. All the floor, right? All the floors were. Sorry.
Well, no, they were.
You know what zamboni is, Pete?
I do, but they have a floor machine.
Yeah,
puts down whatever fluid you put into
exactly.
It.
Exactly.
It buffs it into the floor and then squeezes it back up all in one shot.
All in one shot.
I used to operate when I was at Cathedral.
Yep. And then the walls, they actually have spray disinfectant that you can just spray and leave on the walls.
Right.
The desks were cleaned. I mean, things were taken care of in the building last night so that we could open today.
Yeah.
And I, you know, I will close when the health department people tell us that we need to.
Tell them when it's warranted. By the way, you like our rookie director over here?
I'm noticing that.
This is the first time behind the board over here.
All right, who is he? We got to know who he is now.
Oh, Mr. Douglas is running the board.
Oh, all right.
Oh, that's what I thought.
All right.
Yeah, good job.
Thank you, Mr. Douglas.
Thank
good
you.
To have you.
Thank you.
So, you know, it wasn't warranted closing the school today,
right.
And someone on Facebook tagged me and said I should know better to close the schools. I want to throw it out there. I do not have MD after my last name, and I have to rely on the guidance of the health professionals who are very talented at what they do.
Well, and again, like we've said several times, our local health department is fantastic.
Yes.
But they're getting their lead from Massachusetts, who's getting their lead from the feds, who's
from
getting
the
their lead from the World Health Organization. Like it's
everybody's working together.
Everyone's collaborating and working together. And I think
they're trying to prevent what happened in Italy.
Correct. And here, and I'm going to say this, and I'm going to and I've got 24 years here working in this city. Okay, so I have a lot of relationships with a lot of people.
Yep.
And if I fracture a couple today on the air, I'm going to apologize in advance. But the bottom line is people have to trust us. Okay, trust us, right? That's why we're in the positions that we're in. It's why we work with the people we work with. We're not going to put people at risk.
Never.
And safety. For people to even think that or post that or...
And there are some that are or, it's offensive.
Not only is it offensive,
it's wrong.
It's irresponsible. It's irresponsible.
And it's sending the wrong message.
That's
I'll tell you what, Pete, you've worked with me for how many years? You know my top priority has always been kids and our staff in our district,
yeah.
Whether I was a principal here or an assistant principal here or the superintendent.
That's right.
So the fact that people are putting that stuff out there, really, I'm going to call it out right now. I really can't stand Facebook, and I really would love I wanted to close my account.
You got to get rid of it, man. That's
because it causes me to lose sleep. The stuff right. that people say that if they won't say to my face.
I wonder, but you know, at this point, everybody is scared
People are scared of what they don't know. You fear what you don't know.
Yeah, fear of the unknown.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's motivating a lot of people to do things they normally wouldn't do.
But you do have to trust the healthcare professionals.
Right.
And that's what I put my faith in. I think we have to listen to them because they certainly know more than we do. And if you read it on Facebook, it doesn't mean it's true.
Right.
And that's what people are.
Well, and that's the other thing, too.
And you know what?
Right.
And if the health professionals are getting it wrong, then that's part of the thing. They're doing the best with the information that they have.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right.
And that's what people don't seem to understand. The problem is the culture we're in right now in the political realm and just in general is
just not trusting.
Nobody believes anybody.
Right.
So you believe what you may have heard by one guy over here. I've been seeing stuff on Twitter that's supposedly a doctor, an epidemiologist in Italy. But if you look on his profile, it says he's in California. So how is he posting stuff about Italy if he's in California? You know, I've seen people repost things. And it's just, it gets you nervous. But I don't think that's also very warranted. That you know, you should be wary, right?
Yeah.
It's well, so different for the flu season.
Well, that's what I was going to say, Pete. It's the good practices of daily hygiene are what we should things that we should be doing anyway.
Stuff I mentioned earlier.
Yeah, it's heightened. If there's been a positive of this, it's reaffirmed or made more of an awareness for people that basic things that we do to keep ourselves clean, you know, i.e. washing our hands with hot soap and
water. I will
water
tell you that the 20 seconds is longer than I used to do it. But
no
I also used to not brush my teeth for 2 minutes until I got the electric toothbrush that tells
that,
me
that
how long
it.
I do it.
Right.
So it times it.
You know, and
so, yeah.
And right now, does it make sense for, you know, like, listen, I'm a big handshaker.
Yeah.
I love shaking people's
me
hands.
Too.
It's what I do. So right now, if I have to not shake people's hands or bump elbows with them, so be it.
The elbow bump, the
right.
fist bump, whatever.
Exactly.
You know,
so be it for now.
It is, yeah.
You know, and but here's the thing. I also want to applaud the preventative nature of how people are working and collaborating together.
Absolutely.
Well, like, and even from the federal government. I mean,
right.
I know that people were getting on the president last night for doing what he did, but that's a warrant that at this point might be a little too soon. But it is also a measured, warranted response.
Right? Well, same with the NCAA with saying they're going to play their tournament games
without
fans.
Right.
But the NCAA, word on the street is about to make another announcement at some point in time today.
They're going to suspend it, yeah.
Wouldn't
yeah,
surprise
right.
me if
well,
they suspend
the
it.
Well, because the NBA last night, right?
Well, the NBA's had players now tested positive.
Just one so far.
Right. And I think,
Utah,
but they are postponing the season or delaying
what
the season.
What they'll do, I think, is they'll suspend this. This is what they'll probably do. Suspend the season with the records as they are right now.
Yeah, yep. Little hiatus.
And then determine once the wave crashes,
right.
blows through and fizzles,
right.
they'll pull up the playoffs with the standings as they are now.
Right.
Same thing with the NHL, probably going to follow suit and do the same thing.
Agreed.
And then baseball will postpone the beginning
yeah,
of their season.
They'll delay opening day.
Play yep. a shortened season.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's going to happen, too.
And those are all warranted
responses.
Well,
it's this large crowd thing. The other thing I want folks to know, too, and we kind of alluded to it. You had talked about it with your son. I mean, we have canceled all international trips for this school year. So that included a trip to France. We had a trip to Italy, actually, Pete.
Mm-hmm.
And
how long ago was
Denmark?
That?
Denmark. Well, so the trips were supposed to happen over April break. And so we canceled them last week, and there's been, you know, the staff members have notified the students for sure. But one of the concerns is, too, is we're fighting right now for refunds for our kids.
Right. And well, Timmy was doing the same thing.
These tour companies, and I do get where they're coming from. However, this is a very unique situation. I understand they're running a business, and they can't lose their shirt or clothes. I mean, that's the reality. But we also have to do what's right and what's fair. Certainly, the students and the school district did not bring on the coronavirus to make this happen to inconvenience the tour companies. It's not what happened, folks. So I think there has to be a responsibility piece and some sort of compromise, and we're working with each company individually. But and so in terms of local and out-of-state field trips, we are canceling out-of-state field trips at least, but a lot of it's case-by-case basis. But and local field trips, we're probably going to be stopping all of those. You know, I urge people to contact their building principal because it is a case-by-case basis. Like this week I had allowed our elementary schools to go to the Springfield Science Museum.
Yep.
But today's trip didn't occur because there was so much concern from parents that we just thought it was the right thing to do to
and that's okay too.
Postpone it or cancel it outright. Yeah, and that it is, but we're leaving it up to that. But the other thing too, I've had emails today, people asking me who the staff member was that may have been exposed to some
federal law.
That's called FERPA, folks.
Yeah, FERPA, HIPAA, one of them.
Whatever you want to call it. Yeah,
I don't know what those acronyms are, but I know the HIPAA FERPA thing. Like it's
HIPAA is Health Information Protecting and Something Act.
And what's FERPA?
I don't know what.
Well, that's federal records and educational records.
We cannot share that information with people, and you know, it really confidentiality has to be maintained at all times according to federal regulations, right?
But that's the panic part of it.
But information for reasons about absences, travel history, and illness, we can't give that out. We can't. It must be protected. And it's interesting because, you know, I have my superintendent listserv, and I'm not going to say which district, but one of the superintendents has been quarantined in Massachusetts himself. And he's been writing about how he's been treated. He's been bullied. He's been really harassed because people think that he's going to be the one that spreads it. Now, he's self-quarantined based on travel. And he says, I'm amazed at the way that I've been treated. It's really disappointing.
And you would think...
this is, the fear of the unknown, right?
This is... Going back, Pete, I just want to echo that. We are... Not we, because I'm not. I'm going to exclude myself
from
the
population.
But the population, the fear drives the emotion, or the emotion drives the fear, whichever chicken and egg, whichever you want to say first. And then for anyone to treat anyone who is suffering from any kind of medical condition in that regard has totally lost their marbles, you know, without question.
But again, I think that's also the society we've come to at this point.
Right.
And I'm hoping that people learn from this. I don't think they will.
I do too. This is unprecedented. I've never seen this in my lifetime. Have you?
Well,
we've talked about other diseases like this, and they haven't. They've all fizzled.
Right.
Yes.
They also have been virulent.
Don't forget, we had the H1N1 outbreak.
Mm.
Okay. Yeah. Now, I was the principal of the middle school, one of the middle schools at the time, and I can tell you that over a 2-week period, we had over 100 kids absent every single day. Now, that didn't mean every single student had H1N1. I don't even know if any of them did. But
there's a fear.
A lot of it was flu, regular flu.
Which we still have,
by
the
way,
in Massachusetts.
Okay?
Still.
And the fear-based pieces.
Right.
The difference back then was the media coverage wasn't what it is now.
True.
And there wasn't this massive fear that everyone that caught quote unquote swine flu was going to die.
You can't turn on the TV right now without coronavirus.
Well,
coronavirus.
I remember the guidance from CDC at the time of swine flu was it's going to be an upper respiratory ailment.
Right.
People that are compromised or any other such thing should be very wary of it.
Same thing.
That was the same guidance they were giving. But here the deal on this one is they still don't have a lot of data on it. So
The
swine flu developed slowly.
Yes.
But
this was fast.
Because it came out of, it came through South America and things like that, up through the Texas coast, as I recall. This one is being transmitted because it had such a long shelf life incubation period.
Yeah.
Right.
That everybody got on airplanes. And if you read the people who do, novels about, terrorism, things like that, that's how they they get stuff like that out. That's how the biological pandemic start is. Everybody goes on, get into a metal tube and just spreads it around the world.
Right. So, airplanes are petri dishes, pretty much.
Well, I mean, but you're in a confined space.
Yeah. Recycled air.
Recycled air.
Just like mm-hmm. with a cruise ship, you're in a confined space, right? So,
by the way, just to piggyback that, Pete, anyone thinking about going on a cruise anywhere right now should rethink those plans.
Yeah.
For the same reason you were talking about earlier, forget that you could get sick, but you might you're not coming back.
Right, are you prepared to be off the coast for a month,
right.
maybe?
They're
going
to hold you out there until they can.
They are.
Until
hey, listen, Pete, I just, it's already 9:17.
Yeah, we haven't taken a break
take
yet.
A break or something?
Sure.
All right. All right, folks, we're going to take a break. We'll be back in a few minutes. Thanks for listening.
You can get a coffee.
Radio on WSKB provided by Westfield Electroplating. Employing over 140 skilled platers, painters, and technicians, Westfield Electroplating was founded in 1946 and was the first company in the country to achieve National Aerospace and Defense Contractor Program accreditation, proudly maintaining that status for over a decade. Westfield Electroplating provides over 50 quality finishes to meet your corrosion, cosmetic, or performance needs. On the web at www.westfieldplating.com or 413-545-2000. 568-3716. Westfield Electroplating, putting the finishing touches on technology.
Hi, it's Bob Plass, and I have Wow It's Tuesday every Tuesday, 6 to 8. Wow It's Tuesday.
Community Radio
89.5 WSKB.
I did it!
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Hey, and again, welcome back to Superintendent Spotlight. We talked about the coronavirus and how it's affecting Westfield schools, so I do want to go there again, and we're going to talk
Should
about
Should I do
this.
The disclaimer that I do for Kenny?
What's that one?
Yeah. The views expressed by the hosts are not necessarily those of Westfield State University, the underwriters, the radio club, the general populace in general, that kind of thing.
Oh.
You know,
but our views are common sense. Can you put
yes.
that in the disclaimer?
Yes.
Okay.
That's fine.
Can I just make one comment
to
the disclaimer?
A
Is this our third or fourth year on the show?
Fourth.
Okay. At least fourth, yeah.
I don't think you've ever read the disclaimer
no.
on any of our shows so
no.
far.
No, I didn't think I needed to this time, but I know that you know, you're very passionate about this, so I just want to make sure that people are aware of that.
You know, passionate, Pete, because I've dedicated my career and life to the safety of our staff and students, and to have it questioned
right.
is frustrating.
And that's what I mean. That's what I'm trying to convey.
I mean, if anyone that knows me will tell you the first thing I will tell you, oh, he really cares about the kids. I mean that's pretty much, you know. So to hear that is very frustrating.
And I know a lot of people are frustrated with events getting canceled this weekend and stuff
they
like
are.
That. But it's out of an abundance of caution.
Well, so here's the thing, and that's thank you. That's you know,
nice
I like
segue.
When
Pete
it's gives
a pretty good segue there,
Pete
Peter.
I did after communicating with the health department. Again, I don't just wake up and like, oh, let's cancel this. I think I want to cancel this.
Well, it's the same thing with like canceling for a snow day.
Well,
you have to, you're the lot of people you talk to.
And it was interesting because I was talking to someone yesterday, a teacher, that I still need to get the message out that I'm not the only one who makes that call, Pete.
Right, I know.
I think
We've
I've said
talked
it for
about
4
this for
years.
Yeah.
And people still think, what is the superintendent thinking? The superintendent is thinking that after he spoke to the police department, to the
Who's
DPW,
the
our maintenance
roads.
Crew,
yeah.
the mayor, that he made the best decision that he could with the information that he had.
Right.
That's what people need to know.
Yeah.
And if the police department tells me that the roads are slick even on the side roads, then I'm going to do a 2-hour delay.
Yeah.
All right? Because I care about the safety of our kids. But that's a whole other thing. So when the Pops concert, you know, that was postponed. And we also had to postpone Peter Pan, which was at the intermediate school, middle school, this weekend as well. And I want people to know, like, I'm absolutely cognizant of the work that our students put into that. I am so cognizant
right, and actually,
of that.
Same with
doing,
the middle school concert next week.
What we're doing is if that never comes to fruition, I'm going to go over there and help them this afternoon.
Thank you, Pete. Well, I called him yesterday.
I was already in contact with the librarian.
Okay.
Sarah. Yeah.
So I was already in contact with her. We were going to make that happen.
Right.
But in regards to circumstances, they should have a record of a dress rehearsal.
Oh, absolutely.
Kind of like playing a basketball game in an empty stadium.
And
you know?
Pete, thanks to you in this studio, we now have the capability.
Right.
Which is nice. We didn't have that before. But, you know, I'm disappointed. I love the Pops concert. You know, the first one that came to mind, though, is Pete, the Friday one where the folks from the Senior Center come into Westfield.
They're
High
basically
School.
The audience.
They right. are the audience.
Right.
And you know, so that didn't make a lot of sense either. And so anything with large crowds at this point, we're trying to minimize. So the Pops concert, Peter Pan, the Spring Sing, that was going to be April 4th, I believe. And we've also postponed, and I'm using the word postponed because I am optimistic that we'll be able to reschedule these things. Into the Arts is postponed.
Well, these are stuff that don't have drop dead dates per se.
Exactly.
Correct.
So they
we
can
just
be moved.
Typically did them in March, but
right.
doesn't mean we can't do them in May or June.
Right. And if there's a possibility that we can do it, we're going to. Now, you know, again, most field trips are canceled. We're still waiting to hear a little bit from the athletics with MIAA, I think.
Yeah, they made a call because I know NESCAC. The New England Small College has canceled all their spring sports.
All their sports,
right?
Too.
And the MIAA did tell us last week that something was supposed to come this week. Maybe they're holding off till next week till they get some more information.
Right.
But I would think that with what the NCAA has done, that again, we're at a different level. We're not making the money that the NCAA is making on something like a tournament.
And they're willing to forego that. So.
And they're foregoing right. it. So.
Well, listen, the NBA is willing to forego what
yep.
they're doing too.
Yep.
You know, and I think it's important too. You know, and again, just to go back to the intermediate school, there's a great article that'll be in Westfield News today. Joe Rouse put something out last
Fantastic
night. I want to say
article.
That about the whole process that went down yesterday that people are still criticizing. But Joe Rouse says in the article that he felt with the information that we had, nobody else has, right? It wasn't necessary to close the school today. Had we received that, we would have closed it. So I do want to put that out. I am somewhat curious how the attendance is at the school today.
I'm going to run that as soon as I get back. But you know what?
But that's caution by the parents.
And
that's okay too.
And I just want to echo that. That's okay.
Absolutely.
That's okay because even at the highest levels of the state in DESE, they have basically changed the I don't want to say not attendance requirements. Kids still have to go to school, but how we're graded as a school based on chronic absenteeism and attendance.
That has changed.
Even that's changing, too, because they realize,
they know what's gonna happen.
So, thank you. My gosh, you guys are segueing into things for me. I don't even have to bring this stuff up.
That's why we work well as a team.
Yeah. We've been doing this for a little while.
Well-oiled machine.
You know, we received information from Jeffrey Riley. He is the Commissioner of Education for the state of Massachusetts. And he has basically, the big thing is the 180-day requirement. So what we know right now is that all days lost, and Amy, I gave this to Amy Porter. She did a nice story.
Yes, nice story.
About this yesterday.
Yeah.
All days lost to health, weather, and safety emergencies between the first day of school year and March 15th must be made up by rescheduling full days to ensure a 180-day school year.
Okay.
That has happened.
So
now.
Anything prior to March 15th, we need to make up.
Right. This is the 12th,
Monday or
folks.
Tuesday, yeah.
Right. So look at it this way. Had I closed the intermediate school, this is a day they would have had to make up today. So all days lost to health, weather, and safety emergencies between March 16th and June 1 must be made up to ensure a 180-day school year or until the district has reached its previously scheduled 185th day, whichever comes first. So we have used 3 snow days this year so far. So we have 2 days under that rule to still use, which would get us out of school on June 23rd. They said if all 5 snow days have been used prior to this point, the district is not required to schedule additional snow days. And then the commissioner also said that districts will not be expected to make up any days lost to health, weather, or safety emergencies that occur after June 1st.
Correct.
Okay. So I think that's pretty clear.
Very fair, too.
It's very fair.
Very fair.
We also know they're revising. So school districts, and Chris knows all about this because I made him in charge of the task force we have, our attendance task force. But for accountability purposes, okay, because the DESE is now looking at us in terms of if we have too much absenteeism, it's going to affect your accountability, what your school is rated or leveled, if you will, but they don't level anymore. But they're going to calculate chronic absenteeism as of Monday, March 2nd. They will not use attendance data for the rest of the year, which is music to our ears in our perspective, right? But we do also, if we close the school, we have to notify DESE. I think that's
correct.
Important.
Yes.
Is that normal if you close the school?
No, it's just they want to know if we're closing it for virus purposes.
Okay, so for health-related reasons so they can track that.
They want to know. And, they're also encouraging for us to cancel any out-of-state travel that has been planned.
Right.
The state has
said that. Well, I think that's just, like I said, that's a warranted, a prudent and warranted measure.
Of course it is. But what I want to point people out, so is let's say, I had people say, so if we close for the rest of the year after March 16th and you use your 2 days, we don't have to have school anymore.
That's not true.
Well, I want people to know this too. We are still responsible to educate children.
Right.
Yes,
are. And I think with MCAS coming up, and who knows what's going to happen?
Well, who knows what's going to happen?
If it does happen and continue to happen, us not having school is not benefiting the children that have to take the MCAS exam, particularly
correct.
The 10th graders who need to pass it to graduate.
Right.
So, I mean, there's a delicate balance that has to happen here, and we wrestle and juggle with it. We meet as a team regularly to discuss these things, but that's a huge factor. So, it's not that we can't, you know, and maybe the kids would love to hear that. Sorry, the kids in the,
you know, camera operators.
Yeah, but we still have an obligation to prepare you. And the other thing too is I want people to know we have a lot of kids who actually like school and don't want to miss school. And I'm thinking of this particular school, but all of them. But in this school, kids that are going out on co-op, that means that ends. I mean, there's the ramifications of school closure are huge. It's not, and people have to look at the big picture, which is what I tend to look at the big picture and try to not stay in that narrow frame of mind. So I think that's important to keep in mind. So, you know, there's some other questions that people, you know, I did put together a frequently asked questions on the coronavirus, Pete. Then we're going to take a break, and then we're going to come back and talk about the Student Opportunity Act. How's that sound?
Sounds good to me.
All right. So we had some frequently
asked
questions.
But a lot of good information is getting out there today.
Good. What is the district doing to keep the schools clean and prevent the coronavirus? So I want, again, we are conducting daily cleaning of doorknobs, handles, bathrooms, eating areas, and food prep areas, utilizing routine cleaning methods and products, okay? I want people to know that we've been doing the deep cleaning already because of the bad flu season that we've had.
I think that's part of the reason that the healthcare organizations and the CDC, we had a really bad flu season. A lot of people are weakened from that. And then this on the heels of it might not be a great thing. So I think that's part of the reason for their concern about it.
Well,
I don't think that's a reason for a panic, but
I agree. See, we have this mist of sanitizing solution. I don't know what else to call it. I don't want to use this word, but I don't know what else to say. It's like a spray gun.
Yeah.
I don't like the word you used, the last word.
Like you would use like a spray bottle.
Yeah, but it's not something you wipe down. You spray it down on the surface. Yeah. It dries up.
It's
that's
like
why we do it at night.
Your can of Lysol at home. It's probably the same type of thing.
Right. Frequently asked questions. I've heard other districts are canceling school to sanitize their classrooms. Is Westfield canceling? Why or why not? Listen, when we heard of a situation, we did it. And we know that we've asked our custodians 2 weeks ago to implement these procedures.
And they have.
And we also know that if some schools have been short-staffed, Pete, we've been moving people around to help out to make sure that it's getting done every night.
Absolutely.
Right?
And like you mentioned earlier, it's making sure all of our surfaces are including doorknobs, door handles, tables, you know, things are being sanitized daily.
Daily. And I think someone told me they went to Costco yesterday, and at Costco they're wiping down the carriages because, listen, shopping carts are probably one of the more disgusting things there are.
And that's why...
And wiping them down for people before they give it to them.
But that's another reason why the hand washing is the most important thing.
So critical.
Because let's be honest, folks, we can't wipe down every single surface on planet Earth.
But you can wash your hands regularly. Another question. My child has a serious medical condition, and I am considering removing them from school until the threat of the coronavirus is over. What should I do? I want you to know we understand your concern, and you also need to know that your child's well-being is our top priority. So while the threat is still very low, and Pete, there are no confirmed cases or presumptive cases in Hamden County right now. Right?
Zero.
Right. Zero.
But the other thing, too, is if you have a child or even a staff member that has immunocompromised,
correct.
Talk to your physician and get guidance from them.
I was going to say. Either contact your primary care, if it's a child, your pediatrician, and see what they tell you.
Contact the health department. They may say it may be warranted to have your child out of school for a period
of
time.
And that's fine, and we have mechanisms for that. We can send home tutors. We can put you online learning. We have online
segments. Google Classroom is a wonderful thing right now.
We're using Google Classroom all over the place. But I do want to encourage people that are in that situation to please call Dr. Martha Von Mehring. 413-572-6556. She works with our school nurses, and she'll be able to provide you additional information. So I think that's important. And then people in the community are traveling internationally all the time. What if one of them is diagnosed? Listen, if someone in our community were to be monitored for possible symptoms, we would be notified by the Department of Health, and we would take the appropriate actions similar to what we did yesterday. But any, you know, those are the top questions that I've received, so I thought we would go with that. So that being said, Pete, it is 9:35.
Got a new director in here. Sam is in here now.
All right.
But before we go for a break, I do want to say Tiger's Pride Restaurant is open today.
Yes, it is.
Now, I heard something.
What's that?
That tomorrow will be the last buffet until further notice.
Okay.
And that's because when you have a buffet.
That's the guidance that you're getting.
Right.
That they have the provisions for it now. but they're going to hold back on ordering stuff for that kind of an event. So,
well,
going forward.
It makes sense because the buffets attract 75 to 80 people.
I was going
to
say, and a lot of seniors.
Correct.
And a lot of seniors, Pete.
Mm-hmm. I know. That's what I'm saying. It's another warranted step.
But they can have sit-downs because that usually, the tops you'll get there is 30, 40.
Plated service, yeah.
Right. And they can come in 10:45 to 12:15. Today's soups are carrot soup with blue cheese and cream of broccoli. The salads, they have a turkey cob salad, of course, their regular salad. But, Chris, what are the entrees today?
Well, I was looking at that. Sorry.
That
balsamic pork tenderloin.
That doesn't sound horrible.
Marinated in fresh herbs and spices. Balsamic caper sauce served with scalloped potatoes and sautéed squash.
Stacey knows I don't like capers. Yeah.
Chicken francais.
That's delicious.
Egg batter and sautéed in lemon wine sauce served with scalloped potatoes and sautéed squash. So,
see, I made a nice pork loin.
Well, they have sandwiches. Time. They're cold and grilled. Their sandwich special today is a buffalo chicken wrap.
That sounds good.
It does. So stop by, folks, for a terrific lunch made for you by our students here at Westfield Technical Academy.
And they also have to do serve safe, right?
They do.
Students,
yes.
They do serve safe, so they know how to take care of that safety protocol.
Well, the food, our food prep areas. So you know, all of our cafeteria workers, Pete, are safe serve trained too. Imagine. And they also know how to clean the surfaces before we serve food to our students in the cafeteria. So,
yep.
All right, we're going to take a quick break. We'll be back in a few minutes. Thanks for watching and listening.
classroom. Too hurt they try and try. Strong words in the staff room. The accusations fly. It's no use. He sees her. He starts to shake. He starts to cough. Just like the old man in that famous book by Nabokov. Just stand so.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Barnes & Noble College Bookstore in the Ely Campus Center, offering Westfield State t-shirts, sweatshirts, and gift merchandise. All of your academic needs, and offering textbook materials in new, used, ebook, and rental formats. Available at the bookstore on campus or online at westfieldstate.bncollege.com.
Listen to me, Michael Buster McMahon, Mondays 8 to 10 a.m. to learn the stories behind your favorite songs. Or don't, I'm not the boss of you.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM, WSKB Westfield.
And we're back with Superintendent Spotlight, broadcasting live from beautiful Studio 120. Very nice to have a full staff today. We've got a producer, we've got a director, we've got our students behind the cameras. It's been a great show so far, and we are gonna change topics though. We are gonna move
We're corona'd out.
You're not the only one.
Yeah, we are gonna move to not that that's not educational, because I believe the whole purpose
it is. And I just again right. Closing comment is, please know, folks, we're going to do the best that we can with the information
that
we have.
In a nutshell,
we care about all of our students and staff and families and. We will be communicating as much as we know when we can. But we're going to segue a little bit to the Student Opportunity Act, because that's something else that the state and dropped.
That's
on
something
us
I know
this
nothing
year.
About.
Yeah. Oh well,
educate me.
Here you go.
We had to come up with a plan. All right. So what was supposed to happen is, as for folks that don't know, the governor and the state legislature passed the Student Opportunity Act, which is supposed to infuse $1.5 billion into education over the next 7 years. So every district is supposed to get a certain amount of money. Now, it was sold, I'll be truthful, as if though every district was going to get a healthy amount of money. That did not necessarily come to fruition. In fact, Westfield is getting about the same amount of an increase as we typically would have gotten from Chapter 70 funding increase based on inflation and things like that for students. So, but either regardless of how much money you get, and some districts got like a $10,000 increase. Ours is about $500,000. So, but we still had to come up with a plan of things to do to help address the achievement gaps between our subgroups. And so Chris is going to talk about that for a second.
So what's a subgroup?
All right. So here we go. So ultimately, like Stefan said, the purpose of this Student Opportunity Act is to help districts with some additional funding to close what we call the achievement gap. And that has been really since you and I became administrators, maybe even when we were teachers.
Yeah.
It's been the biggest challenge in across the state, really, because Massachusetts, if people don't know, always ranks number one or near number one across
the country for education.
Education on the NAEP testing. And
what's NAEP testing?
Well, that's the national national test that's done across the country.
Okay.
Basically, our kids always score
for math and reading.
Particularly math
and reading.
Yep. So in Massachusetts, our bar is set pretty high. But across the Commonwealth, where we struggle is closing the achievement gap with what we call our subgroups. And Pete, you asked, well, what are subgroups? So every school has a percentage of students that are on an IEP or in a 504.
So students with disabilities, that's a subgroup.
Okay. We have every school has a percentage of students that are considered economically disadvantaged. Okay.
That's our largest subgroup, which is about 40%.
Well, and that's why this community is really unique. You go from rural to metro in one town.
But what the state has said, and this is not rocket science, there are achievement gaps between students in those subgroups compared to students who are not.
Yep.
And our job is to close those gaps.
And usually without money to do it.
Well, and the other...
We need money to do it, yes.
And the other subgroup that that we are very cognizant of in Westfield, because we always have an influx of, like any other community, but we have an influx of refugees and people from other countries.
EL.
We have our EL students.
English learners.
So people that are not natively speaking the language.
Imagine they also have an achievement gap, Pete. Put on your shocked face.
Right.
Yeah, right. No. Because they're, they're trying to do double duty.
Yeah.
They're trying to learn language and learn the stuff that they need to be taught.
And then there's a larger umbrella of called high needs. So any student who is in any of these categories, and guess what, folks? A lot of these students are in more than one.
Sure.
Okay.
Well, it makes sense.
That makes sense. So it's considered to be the high needs subgroup. So the idea is how do we...
That's 48% in
Westfield. Which, like Stefan said,
about half our kids.
So how do we close the gap between students who are English speaking, not economically disadvantaged, not with any educational special needs, and the other half that are? How do we close that achievement gap? So that's part of the work that needs to be done with the Student Opportunity Act.
Okay.
And we presented our plan last week to the school committee. I did post the video on our school district website as well as our Facebook page of our presentation. There's some terrific questions from the school committee. And I want to point this out because Monday night coming up, we have a school committee meeting at 7 o'clock, and there is public participation after I give a five-minute recap of our total presentation.
So questions from the audience.
Comments. We really can. The only thing we're going to do is correct misinformation. The plan is the plan. We have to submit it to the state by April 1. But we had to pick three areas to focus on.
Right.
And again, I would have loved to pick new areas if we were getting the funding we were supposed to get. But really what we're able to do with the funding we're getting is strengthen the areas we're already working on.
Yes.
Okay.
So one being expanding access to full day, high quality pre-kindergarten for four-year-olds. Now, what we know, is that there are students in our downtown area that are attending our elementary schools, Pete, with no preschool at all.
Okay.
So they're already starting. They might
behind
be economically disadvantaged. They might be EL. They might need an IEP and be on special education or 504.
So any education, get them at an earlier
age. And they're coming to kindergarten with
nothing.
With already a gap.
So they're playing catch up for 12
right
years
away.
Of our schools.
Right.
Because 13 years. Because they haven't had any preschool. And, preschool, you do get taught a lot of students. So as we're talking about, Pete, building a new elementary school, too, we're looking at maybe putting a preschool in there, because I think that will attract. We know that it's the downtown area where we're seeing an absence of preschool. So if we put a preschool in this new elementary school, maybe that'll change things.
I have a left field question for you on this topic. Is there anything that parents can do to help the kids make up that skills gap at home? Is there anything that they can do over and above what
absolutely,
you guys are able to
do? Absolutely, but they should. You know, the reality is obviously as a parent, you should be reading to your kids. You should be a good friend of mine had a baby recently, and the kid's 3 years old. He can already count and redo the alphabet and things like that.
Sure.
All right, those are really important skills, and really just exposing students to things they need to know.
And to piggyback on that, the academic piece is huge. the reading, the you know, knowing your numbers, knowing your alphabet, you know, getting involved.
Social skills.
But the social skills are massive. You know, like how do we express our feelings in a positive way? How do we share?
How do we interact with others in general?
How do we interact in general, right? Yeah. Those are things that some of our kids come into kindergarten with and have absolutely no concept of.
And it's not, listen, we're not doing the blame.
Oh, no, not at all.
We're just trying to help. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, they just, right.
We are. So we're going to look at what we can do, and it's just a three-year plan. So we know as we're looking at this elementary school, that might be a piece. We might try a pilot program, you know, at some point for a full-day pre-K, because Fort Meadow is largely just half-day, all right?
Correct.
And we have to look at that. So that's one. Another one is dropout prevention and recovery programs. And so we opened Pathways, the Pathways program, or the Westfield Alternative Learning Center, which is a part of the Westfield High School program. It's just off campus. And, you know, one of the things we need to do is we know that we're located at Camp Togawak, and its capacity is only 50 students, but we probably have 50 students waiting to get in. And we need to expand the program to meet the needs of all of our kids. But I want to tell you, that was one of my top priorities when I became superintendent, was to develop this program. When I came in, our district dropout rate was about 2.7%. I'm proud to say we're down to 1.3%.
1.3.
So we have saved a lot of kids, re-engaged kids that have already dropped out, but we need to grow the program. So that's one of the funding areas that we'd like to see expanded. And then the other piece is early college program focused on students that are underrepresented in higher education. And that is our Westfield Promise program, because the first students we try to attract into that program are first generation folks, families or kids that comes from families. Like it's interesting. No one in my family went to college. I'm the first college graduate out of my family. All right. So I would have been considered in that group. And so we're trying to get people who think, oh, you know what? I can't go to college. No one else in my family did.
Sure you can.
Those are the first people. And they try it out through those 11th grade stretch courses we offer. And then they continue to 12th grade taking classes at Westfield State's campus. But what we're trying to do is grow those cohorts. So we have two cohorts of students doing that in 11th grade at Westfield High School. We want two cohorts here. We actually want a third cohort at the high school. So the funding can go toward that. But the other question that comes up is, you know, all right, so we talked about the subgroups.
Yep.
Right. So in terms of special education, well, what are you doing? Well, first of all, the preschool proposal actually helps students probably be less likely to be on a special education plan if we're able to catch them up. Because a lot of times they're put on an IEP because they're far behind and they need accommodations to catch up.
Right.
But if we're able to get that really just the skills that they need to be successful in school at an earlier age, we're helping the students. But I also want folks to know, we know we're hiring another educational team leader to work with our families in terms of IEP meetings, because we know the caseload is too high. We also know that in terms of social skills, we need another behaviorist to work with some of our kids who have social skills deficits, and we need to bring them up to where they need to be. So
that's right.
We know that. So that's how we're supporting special education.
Okay.
In terms of English learner programs, we are hiring additional staff. There's going to be a full-time staff member here to work with EL students, and also we're going to be adding hopefully an additional tutor or two or even a translator to help these students when they're in their classrooms, so they can do that. So those are the EL piece. In terms of low income, you know, I want to bring back the other thing too, the dropout piece. All right. And a lot of, if you look at the data of from students that are dropping out, a lot of them are from low-income families. So, you know, today, if you don't have a high school diploma, you're not getting far at all.
No.
Right.
There's not, I mean, most
can
places.
Can I play devil's advocate a little bit?
Hmm?
Are these things sustainable? Is there guidance saying that this is going to be a sustainable thing, or is it a one-time
shot? You mean the funding?
The funding?
Yeah.
Well, like anything
else, you know
what
I mean? 'Cause that's
it's supposed to be sustainable, okay?
Okay.
We're getting so little money this time because the governor so far has not funded the low-income piece of this bill where it needs to be.
Okay.
And so you're not hearing me talk about a lot of low-income interventions because I can tell you that now the governor's budget, which was released in January, is in the House of Representatives, and they're going to debate this bill, and they will likely add money to that, so we're able to do more. And then it goes to the Senate, and they may add some more or take it away. But Pete, I got to be honest with you, with the state of the economy, I'm looking at the stock market, I'm looking at businesses, and you're going to see things because of this
coronavirus. That was the question.
Yeah. I mean, it's eerily starting to feel like 2008 again when the economy went down the...
Well, I mean, a correction was warranted in the stock market, but
it was.
I'm just worried that you know, I look at it from both sides. You know, I look at it as a taxpayer and as a people, sure, that's somebody that's in the school. Is it sustainable? Because I know that, you know, years and years ago, during the Clinton administration, all these police departments got cop grants, and then, right, they phased out, and then all these people got laid off eventually. You know, or positions got phased out due to retirement, things like that.
I can tell you that I'm trying to be responsible and realizing the stuff that we are adding. Like, if I have to lose a cohort at Westfield State, I'm not happy about it.
Sure.
But it's not the end of the, yeah, world. You know, the full-day access, you know, I want to see full-day preschool because I think there's an advantage to it now. There's a lot of data that tells you there is an advantage to it.
Oh,
that.
Absolutely.
And, yep, I think we have to acknowledge that.
Okay.
So the other piece, too, now is... you know, when you're looking at the, you know, I think the special ed piece I talked about, the English learner piece I talked about, and it's that low income piece that we're doing. You know, we're also working to try to get our schools to be more free lunch for more people.
Sure.
Free breakfast. You know, we're doing these breakfast programs. But I want to say the reason we picked the early college piece and also the pre-K piece,
yes,
is because, you know, when we have received our instructions on how to fill out this plan, those were identified as what they call the multiplier, which means there is likely to be, if the state can afford it, right, grant funds attached to that over a longer period of time to help districts continue to support that work. So that's why we picked them.
Okay. That makes sense.
Yeah. Well, we try to do
that. Well, it made sense.
No, I'm just saying as a layperson, not
correct,
being in the situation you guys are in the day-to-day. That makes sense as you're trying to target things that you know that could be sustainable, which is what people are looking for.
Yes.
Right. And the fact that it would have a big impact on the normal population you have to educate anyways.
Right.
Right. You know, well, I just want to point out one of the other items that we could have selected from the state's list was, you know, a diversified workforce. And I, you know, and Chris and I talk about this regularly because we've been at a few meetings with the commissioner and they're trying to have us diversify our workforce. I have to tell you that we would love to do that. But in Western Mass, in particular, the whole Pioneer Valley, there's a shortage of teachers already. So at this point, as much as I'd love to diversify our workforce, at this point, I just need a workforce, Pete.
Yep.
I mean, we you know, you put out for an ad for a science teacher, you get one person that applies. That's,
yeah,
it.
And
educate. That's long gone from the days when you and I were getting into education.
We talk about that at length too. I think you know, being an educator in the 21st century is a difficult job.
It is.
Okay, it's a very difficult job. The demands, yeah, that are on administrators is one thing, but the demands that are on a classroom teacher are tenfold. And they're working with our kids daily that have all these different kinds of needs. And let's be honest, you don't go into education to make $1 million a year.
It isn't because of the money,
right? No. And it used to be.
You don't go into city government either to make. No.
That's right. That's right.
And
so,
that's another misperception. Right. People are like, oh, look at the pay that they make.
The other misconception too is that people think that we in education don't work in July and August, which is ludicrous. Even teachers are working through the summer preparing for the next year or part of summer programming or
curriculum
development.
Right. And we work, right, all year anyway.
We do. We work all year, right, long.
So, you know, what I want people to understand is we're doing the best. We came up with the best plan that we have. We've addressed the subgroups that we know exist and where the gaps are. And the other thing we really want to work on is improving, is engaging all families. And, you know, I don't know if folks know this, but I do have a superintendent parent advisory board.
Yes.
I love my parents on my advisory board. They give me a lot of guidance. Every school now has a school council, which includes parents. And on the secondary levels, that actually includes students, too. We have a CPAC, the Special Education Parent Advisory Council. They give me feedback, and we've had them on the show before, Pete.
Yep.
We have an LPAC now, which is the English Learner Parent Advisory Council. You run all sorts of Title I family nights. Those have been better attended.
Oh, man,
than ever.
We've never had attendance like this before.
Absolutely. We have, you know, and one of the things we're going to start looking to add as part of our plan is home visits for students in pre-K and kindergarten, and more.
Which we do at one elementary now, and our goal is to move that across the district. So
we want parents, mm-hmm, to feel, you know, welcomed by us. I think there's always been a sense of distrust between parents and educators too. But I want to go back to the pay thing for teachers. That's why we're having this shortage. And I know that people are criticizing even the most recent raise that our teachers received of the 1%. Folks, You go to school, you get 4 years, you get a bachelor's degree, you probably have school loans, you're probably starting making somewhere between $40,000 to $45,000. The state makes you go get a master's degree, so now you're going to have to incur potentially
within five years
more student loans. And it's just, for it's not as attractive. And what we're seeing and hearing is across the country, there are less and less folks going into the field of education.
It's a shortage.
That's why we have the shortage.
Yeah, it's for sure why we have the shortage. So as far as our workforce goes, We're going to hire the best people we can
based on
any given
we
time what right. we what we have.
But it's so. 10 o'clock. 10:01. I think we're over.
That's okay.
All right, but we got to run anyway. But I think anything else you think we should mention? I don't know. Do you understand this?
I think you guys are covering an awful lot today. There's a lot of ground. We may rerun this on Friday.
I think
okay.
so.
Please.
Over the weekend, just as a kind of a primer as to what's going on.
Like
so
I said,
dispel some myths.
Yeah, the NCAA was supposed to make another announcement today about the tournament.
I don't know if they have.
I don't know if they have yet or not, but that might be something for us to look into off the air, too, and update folks on. Because,
and that's going to trend on how athletics go for here for the spring semester.
Well, oh, and again, we're still waiting to hear from the MIAA about what they want to do. You know, we need to play sports. I mean, it's an outlet for kids. But you know what? If we have to take a hiatus here too, we get it.
Yeah, you may have an abbreviated season or something like that.
We get it.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, thanks, folks. Have a wonderful week.
Yeah, next week we have CORE on, which is...
you're not here next week.
No.
Right,
so. Oh, I might be. Depends. We're supposed to go to the show, but to check out their engineering program. That may be postponed.
But I'll be here, and so will Kathy Cattugno.
And Susan Dargie has agreed to co-host in case I'm absent.
In case you're not here.
But we're going to talk about a bunch of things, including Project Embrace, but we'll get back to that next week.
We'll get back to that next week.
So, folks, thanks for listening or watching. Have a great day, and we'll see you next week.
Stay safe, everybody.